Well, have we learned anything since then? You point out the total corruption and self-delusion of the military and the civilian leaders throughout this. First of all, thinking they could wage a techno war, and secondly, having not paying attention to the realities which might try to seep up from the intelligence field, suppressing any intelligence that would contrary to what they wanted. Are we still in that same mode of thinking?
Yes.
And are we thinking of applying it to?
Well, we already have a couple of places. Certainly, Grenada was one example. We took Grenada, and we just barely took it, even though there was a minimum opposition. Most of the U.S. Special Forces commandos bit the dust in various operations because of the various mishaps of one kind or another. Also, the military's analysis is, well, not only did we fight with one hand tied behind our back, but we fought too slow. We needed more rapid escalation. So Honduras has been prepared. A series of airfields and ports had been prepared in Honduras in order to bring 40, 50,000 troops into battle within a week. They have the facilities for this. And they still have, many of the military have the delusion that they could probably take Managua and a few other places in a couple of weeks, rather than an extensive Central American war, which would escalate tremendously, because the Nicaraguans have no choice except to expand the war outside of Nicaragua to make the battlefield bigger. If the battlefield's bigger, then the United States has to disperse its troops. If its troops are dispersed, can't achieve victory.
Back to Vietnam.
Sounds like they haven't learned a thing.
They have not learned a thing. But then most haven't learned a thing. There are veterans, of course, in the U.S. who certainly don't want to see this. There are probably parts of the military in very subordinate positions who don't want to see a major escalation. But generally, we're on track for another kind of major intervention, whether or not it will be, since the Iran-Agua crisis has emerged, that may be off for a while. I don't know. But there's certainly Philippines. There's another growing insurgency there. The chances for another major intervention and another series of self-delusions are very, very high, because the people, the officer corps who were successful in Vietnam are the people who are in charge now. The people who were the dissidents, the few handfuls of lieutenant colonels and majors who just got repulsed, they got out. They resigned. Most of them did. And then the final reason I note the problem of learning is that there are cultural reasons that make the American people want to believe the self-imposed restraint school. And that is, we are used to the tradition of the cowboy who comes in and saves a society against the enemies when the power structure cannot defend itself. The idea of a weak authority that has to be saved by a warrior shows up in many places in American culture. In the Western, in the detective hero is outside the law. All the Superman and the Masked Avenger figures of the 20s and 30s certainly are able to foil criminals that legal authorities cannot.
But also, isn't there a deep belief that technology cannot fail in American culture? That if we have enough technological or military force, we can't help but win a war.
It's hard not to believe in your hardware. Americans don't learn about social relations. They don't learn about class structure every day in the newspaper, or about cultural history every day in the newspaper. They learn about what's for sale.
Then what is the lesson of Vietnam concerning the limits of techno-war, the situations in which
techno-war can destroy, but it cannot achieve victory. It can destroy land, it can destroy people, but it can't create a government, it can't create a culture, it can't create a society.
I mean, this was another thing we tried to do in Vietnam, to impose the model of the consumer society on them, and American-style supposed democracy, where there'd be elections, in situations where these just couldn't work.
Oh, well, it did work in a way. In other words, yeah, people can become corrupted. They did get into their drugs and their Hondas and things, but it just doesn't build a stable society. It doesn't build it doesn't build people who are willing to die for that society. That was the whole problem they had. You had plenty of corrupted Vietnamese, but when it looks like things were near, they weren't willing to go out and defend Saigon to the death, or not. They just did. They bought their tickets out to the United States.
Whereas the peasants were willing to fight to death just for land.
Yes.
And just for getting rid of their landlords or local oppressors.
Yes.
It made perfect sense to them.
And there's been this problem, the so-called Vietnam syndrome, which our leaders have been complaining about all these years, as if there was a sickness in the land. The
Americans, a loss of will to fight, yes.
But it looks like the American public had a clearer picture of what the war was all about than the leaders. But what do you, how would you assess that, and do you think that they were overcoming that Vietnam syndrome now so that they can...
Well, I don't think the American public ever had an idea what was wrong. They just knew something was wrong and that it wasn't getting better. In fact, I think indeed their fuzziness made it easier for people to believe the self-imposed restraint school, mm-hmm. to believe that we lost because we didn't fight hard enough. For the past few years, popular culture has presented the hero, the warrior imagery as well, very much strong on the rise. We've had many classical war movies made and several kind of variant war movies made. It's definitely a war culture. How people, though, clearly, though, there's still a resistance. There's still a certain level in which the disaster of Vietnam is etched in at least some people's memories. And even though they don't have an understanding of why it failed or what the structural reasons, there is a fear that it will happen again.